reading from Srimad-Bhagavatam, Canto 1, Chapter 13 and Text 2. यावतः कृतवान् प्रश्नान् सत्ता कौशारवाग्रतः जातैक भक्तिर् गोविन्दे तेभ्यश्चोपर रामः. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: After asking various questions and becoming established in the transcendental loving service of Lord Krishna, Vidura retired from putting questions to Maitreya Muni. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Vidura retired from putting questions before Maitreya Muni when he was convinced by Maitreya Rishi that the sanmam bonam of life is to be finally situated in the transcendental loving service of Lord Sri Krishna, who is Govinda, or one who satisfies his devotees in all respects. The conditioned soul, the living being in material existence, seeks happiness by employing his senses in the modes of materialism, but that cannot give him satisfaction. He then searches after the supreme truth by the empiric, philosophic, speculative method and intellectual feats. But if he doesn't find the ultimate goal, he again goes down to material activities and engages himself in various philanthropic and altruistic works, which all fail to give him satisfaction. So neither fruitive activities nor dry philosophical speculation can give one satisfaction, because by nature a living being is the eternal servitor of the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna, and all the Vedic literatures give him direction towards that ultimate end. The Bhagavad Gita confirms this statement. Like Vidura, an inquisitive, conditioned soul must approach a bona fide spiritual master like Maitreya, and by intelligent inquiries must try to know everything about karma, fruitive activities, jnana, philosophical research for the supreme truth, and yoga, the linking process of spiritual realization. One who is not seriously inclined to put questions before a spiritual master need not accommodate a show bottle spiritual master, nor should a person who may be a spiritual master for others pose to be so if he is unable to engage his disciple ultimately in the transcendental loving service of Lord Sri Krishna. Vidura was successful in approaching such a spiritual master like Maitreya, and he got the ultimate goal of life, bhakti unto Govinda. Thus there was nothing to be known further about spiritual progress. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Purport. We are reading from the chapter Dhritarashtra Quits Home, and here till this verse the conversation between a great devotee by name Vidura and Maitreya Rishi was described, and in the last verse Atmano Gatim, the destination for the self or the soul, was discussed. And here it is said that yavatah krutavan prashnan, Vidura asked all these questions, and jataika bhakti govinde, when he understood that atmana gati is Eka Bhakti Govinde, the unalloyed devotional service to Lord Sri Krishna, then Tebhyas Cha Upara Rama, he has retired from asking questions. Actually, we don't have any retirement from questions and seeking answers. As soon as we get up in the morning, we start off our questions and answers, and then it goes on till we take rest. Some people may dream also about answers and questions and answers. How can I become a millionaire in 1 month? That's the question, and dream will answer. You know, like that. People are continuously asking questions and trying to get answers. And those questions and answers, as long as they do not reach Eka Bhaktir Govinde, if they do not reach the Govinde, they do not reach to the point of loving devotional service to Krishna, then such questions will continue. Now, why we ask questions? Everybody wants to be happy. Yes? Anybody wants to be unhappy? Anybody goes to the temple for give me unhappiness? They all go in order to ask the Lord to remove all the unhappiness, right? Recently means a couple of years back, the United Nations has released a report. It's called Happiness Report of the World. You know, they go to many individuals, they ask certain questions, and they try to assess the happiness of a country. So United Nations has published an article about the happiness, this thing, and then India was given 118th position. First means the most happiest, and around 125 or 130 is the lowest in happiness. So we got 118th. That is the happiness rank. Probably they have not come to our temple. Those guys who are trying to do survey. So then what happened? Some six people, they wondered how India can be 118th. So they decided to do a survey by themselves. They said, okay, we'll go all over the country and figure out what makes Indians happy. That is their journey. They traveled 10,000 kilometers by their vehicle, traveled all parts of the country, met hundreds and thousands of people, and during all these things they went through a lot of turmoil sometimes. You know, car breakdown in the middle of a forest, and then somebody will come and help them. You know, they were writing their experiences of traveling 10,000 kilometers. And in India, you know, some of the roads, any car will get spoiled. It is, you know, some of the roads are like that. So they travel such far distances and to figure out this. In Chhattisgarh, I think they met one person and they asked, tell me, about your happiness. What makes you happy? Then that person said, whenever you find happiness, you let me know. I am still searching for it. You know, that is one of the answers he gave. And one person, he doesn't have an eye, but still he looked very happy. Somebody has a very small setup, hardly any house, but still he is, you know, happy. After doing all these things, these people wondered how India, you know, is faring 118th position. Looks like everybody is happy. A person who doesn't have a house, a person who has only one eye, a person who is still seeking happiness, everybody looks okay. So they concluded their article by saying that, India is a happy country. Actually, there is nothing lacking in our people. The person here in the purport, if you see, Prabhupada is saying that everybody is seeking happiness. And you ask anybody, how are you? Instantly, what will be the answer? He'll say, I am fine. He may be in ICU, one leg is hanging, and a full bandage, whole body. And then you go and ask him, how are you? I am fine. Little problem. It's not little, he's in ICU. So that's the instinctive, you know, response. But Prabhupada is here, he's talking about one more deeper aspect. is talking about satisfaction. Externally, people can look like they are happy. But when it comes to satisfaction, that is a different kind of a situation. So Prabhupada is saying, although everybody is trying to enjoy in the materialism, but nobody is happy. Nobody is satisfied. Without satisfaction, happiness is not possible. Satisfaction is required. So, they did one survey of the big names of the world. Like, of course, in our country, say, Deepika Padukone. And then Prince Harry, London. Michael Phelps, you know, is a swimmer. Like that, they have asked them certain questions. So Deepika Padukone, she said, I used to get anxiety attacks. And then I used to always feel hollow from within. And then they asked Prince Harry, he said 20 years I was in depression. And then Michael Phelps, he said, I always used to feel loneliness. Loneliness always. And then I'm grateful that I have not committed suicide, but then I was so lonely that all these thoughts were crossing my mind. Now, if you see all these people, either in the movies or TVs or where in the newspapers, you will see their big smiles and bright, colorful faces and energetic moves and interesting movements and all those things we will see. And then we think that they're, yes, they must be happy because everything is there for them. They're having it all, whereas I don't have. And then, since they're having it all, and since I don't have, if I can also have it all, if I also have everything with me, then probably I will be happy. So this happiness and satisfaction is a big subject in the outside world. For centuries they are discussing, yes, what is this? What makes a person happy, satisfied and happy? Sometimes once when we come to Krishna consciousness, in the beginning days, like sometimes one person asked me, Swamiji, Bhagavad Gita says that it is dukkhalayam. This world is full of dukkha. But then when I went to MG Road, where is the dukkha? Everybody is colorful. All buildings are vibrating. So where is this dukkha? this is what. So similarly, these stars are also, they're part of the whole. It's called happiness facade. Facade means, when you say a nice building, front there will be facade. In Hyderabad, you can see outside facade will be very interesting. But when you see behind, it is actually a shed. Front, it is very nice. Very good facade will be there. So, similarly, many of the stars and heroes and all that, they put a happiness facade. But what is there inside? We don't know whether it is a shed or a concrete building or what. We don't know. That is the situation. Now, why do people do this? Because of the competition, social pressure. There'll be social pressure. Let us say you lived in a Ford car, and you're living in a big bungalow, and let us say situation has become worse. Now you have to live in a Maruti 800. Not easy. Why? Because we all know there is a certain social pressure. So the stars and everybody also, they will be under tremendous pressure to maintain their happiness facade, to maintain their levels, to maintain their facilities. They'll all be very conscious of all these things. It's a natural thing in the outside world, in the society. So, when they're like that, trying to be somebody, and actually it is not that. This is what we say. What are these people trying to do? They want to put on some personality, but actually inside that's not their real personality. So they move away from their real personality more and more in order to put up a happiness facade, some other personality outside, and so they suffer inside. They start feeling lonely, empty, hollow, you know, all these issues will be there. Okay, so, but even if you think the, you know, okay, inside personality, you know, if it is not understood and is only maintaining an outside stuff, he will not be happy. A similar situation happens with all the living entities in this world. By nature, we are all something inside, but we are all trying to be putting up a different personality outside. And what is our real personality? That is explained in the Bhagavad Gita, 15th chapter. Mamai vamsho jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatanaha. So all these top heroes and see, the problem with them is they will not be able to come out of it and ask somebody, I need help. This is one more issue. When you are trying to put up the whole thing, you don't like to disclose your weaknesses. You don't like to disclose your miseries, your sorrows. You don't want to. Why? Because that is against what people are perceiving about your personality. So, you know, these people are caught up in a kind of a thing and then they cannot come out of it. They cannot even disclose. A similar situation was there for Sanatana Goswami and Rupa Goswami before they came in touch with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. They were big ministers in the court of the king, that time king, a Muslim king. And so they were actually very big ministers. They have all the facilities of that age, and having it all, they're also having it all. Everything is there. But then they understood that we're actually not happy. And when Sanatana Goswami approached Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said, Ke ami kena amai jane jare tapatrai iha nahi jani kemane hita hai. This is actually a Bengali nice verse. So Sanatana Goswami is asking this question to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. This is very important. It requires humility to be able to submit and tell, yes, I am feeling like this, I have this trouble, I am like this, what do you think is the solution? So they went and asked, Ke ami kina amai ja tapatrai? Who am I? What is my internal personality? I am trying to put up a personality like a big minister and a happy man and having it all those things. But kene amai tapatrai? Why am I suffering like this? Tapatrai means there are three kinds of miseries every living entity goes through. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So, Sanatana Goswami is asking this intelligent question, saying, yeah, everybody calls me Pandit, Everybody calls me, oh, you are a great minister, and I am having it all, but why am I suffering? If I am so powerful, if I am having it all, why am I unable to resolve my miseries? Many times we think, if I have a lot of money, I can cross over all my miseries, all my unhappiness, my ill health, my this, that, everything I can cross over, moment I have everything with me. But then Sanatana Goswami is saying, yes, I am having everything with me, but nonetheless, I am unable to solve my issues. So he's asking, who am I? You know, I'm trying to put up something, that's fine, but I'm not happy. Inside I'm feeling hollow, depressed, all these things. You know, tapatrai, all three kinds of miseries are haunting me. But then who am I? Iha nahi jani, I do not know. Kemane hitahai, what is the real welfare, real benefit of me? I don't know. Actually, this question is considered to be a very intelligent question. As I said, we all will be asking a lot of questions in our life. For example, throughout the day, if there is a, say, a cricket match, India and Pakistan cricket match, somehow you are away from the TV. Generally, we'll be glued to the TV, but let us say you are away from that. What will you do? Continuously, you are checking, what is the score now? What is the score now? Now, this is a question. What is the score now? Is a question. That question's answer will either increase your blood pressure or it will decrease a little bit. It depends on that answer. Okay, so similarly, some of us will be asking questions. What is the today's stock value? We have invested in some stocks. What's happening today? As soon as America killed Iran's second man, the topmost second man, the Indian stocks fell, you know, hugely, you know, some 2 lakh crore or 3 lakh crore worth of loss on that day. Just previous day, the stocks have gone up to the peak. On that day, suddenly, you know, something happened and, you know, dhamal, everything fell down. So, sometimes I hear people looking at this, you know, stock thing. Sometimes they get heart attacks by looking at those. So, everybody is asking questions and seeking answers. But then what is the most intelligent question? This is the most intelligent question. Who am I? Is the most intelligent question. What can really satisfy me within my core? This is the real intelligent question. Otherwise, we may be putting up one show and going on in our life. We may not even know that what is our innermost desires. We may not even know our innermost personality. We will just go on our life, you know, putting up something and then, you know, trying to maintain that position throughout our life. That will be our struggle. So, as soon as Sanatana Goswami asked this, yes, who am I? So immediately Chaitanya Mahaprabhu replied that Jivera Swarupai Nitya Krishna Das. He says, deep inside you are actually an eternal servant of Krishna. Eternal servant of Krishna. So as soon as we understand our identity, then we can work for our real benefit. We can work for the real welfare. We can work for real happiness and satisfaction. If you don't know who you are, you're trying to satisfy, but then it's not possible like that. You don't even know who you are. sometimes we we hear in some movies, you know, when a king, you know, king goes to the forest along with a small child, and somehow something happens in the forest, king goes back to the kingdom, the child is lost in the forest, and then he grows and becomes like, you know, some kind of a tarjan or whatever, you know, you say, no, it becomes like that. Now, I mean, just for the sake of some argument, that boy can be happy only in the kingdom. But now he is in a forest. He will not be happy. Unless and until he realizes who is he realizes that I am the son of a emperor or a king, he will not be having that satisfaction. One more example. One deer was there, and then one lion attacked the deer. It's a pregnant deer, and then it has conceived the child, the cub, the deer cub, and the mother died. And so that cub grew up among the lions. You know, that's the story. The lions will not leave the cub like that. But anyway, the deer cub has grown into a mature or a bigger animal. All the while, the other way around, there are many lions, and one lion has given birth to a cub lion, and the cub lion grew among deers. As the lion is growing, it is thinking, I am also a deer. It is continuously thinking, I am also a deer only. And like the deer, it is also eating grass, it is also eating some vegetables, and it is also moving here and there. Everything is almost like, it's like a deer. Once one more big lion came, and it is pouncing on the, you know, all the deers. So, the, you know, the, everybody is running here, there. And this small lion deer also, it is also running here and there. And finally, the big one caught this small one. And the small one is saying, oh, leave me, leave me, leave me. Big one is saying, "Arey, why are you fearful? No, I am a deer." I said, "No, no, come on, wake up. You are not a deer, you are actually a lion." So that child lion has a big revelation. Wow, really? So you're not going to eat me? No. You know, when the lion is there, but like a deer, it is eating grass because it doesn't know who is he. It is trying to take satisfaction in grass, vegetables, but lion's food is different. Internally, it is a lion only. Unless it eats that, it cannot have satisfaction. So similarly, we are a spirit soul. You know, there is a display there behind, you can see. We are a spirit soul inside. As long as we don't know what is spirit soul, what satisfies the spirit soul, you may be doing many other things, like eating, like this lion cub, it is eating grass and many other things to satisfy itself, but it can never be because it's a lion. Similarly, we are behaving, we are taking many, many things, we are trying to satisfy this body, but it will not satisfy us because we are actually a spirit soul inside. So, what is the satisfaction for the spirit soul? Association of the Supreme Personality. Eka Bhaktir Govinde, what satisfies the spirit soul is unalloyed devotional service to Krishna. You know this metallurgy, somebody from engineering background, you know, metallurgy, there is an alloy. Alloy means, you know, you mix some 2-3 metals and come out with one alloy. It's called unalloyed, means there is no mix of any other thing. It's a pure unalloyed. So, what is expected is unalloyed devotional service to Govinda, Krishna. That means our devotional service cannot be mixed with any other thing. So, this is also called pure devotional service. This is one important point that we have to understand. Bhagavatam is not presenting bhakti. It is presenting Eka Bhakti Govinde. It is presenting unalloyed, exclusive devotional service to Krishna. It is presenting pure, unalloyed devotional service to Krishna alone. Right? Otherwise, bhakti we'll see so much. You know, in this world, there is so much bhakti is there. But the world is not getting any better. Why? Because what is missing is Eka Bhakti Govinda. Now what is this meaning? When we do devotional service, if you have an intention that I should get something out of it, that is called mixed bhakti, alloyed, not unalloyed. For example, we go to any temple, Tirupati, Tirumala, you know, you take a big list of what to ask God when I go, right? We're busy reading it out. No, I want this. Meanwhile, they'll kick you out and you are out of the temple. You're not finished your... So that bhakti is okay. It's good that you are coming to the Supreme Lord, but that's not sufficient. Your questions will not stop. After asking God also, you will be anxious whether it will come or not. Will Balaji give me? Will Govinda give me? Or not? One more anxiety. No. Bhagavatam is not talking about that bhakti. It is talking about jataika eka bhaktir govinde. Exclusive, unalloyed devotional service to Krishna. That means, while rendering service to Krishna, we have no motivation. We are not going to ask anything from the Lord. No motivation. Ahaituki apratihata. No hetu. Why are you chanting? Why are you coming to the temple? Why are you dancing? Why are you honoring prasad? No hetu. It is only to develop my love, my attraction towards the Lord. That's all. No other mix for our own pleasure. We don't look for our sense gratification. We only want to always see Krishna happy. This is something revolutionary for our Indians. And in fact, any other religion you take, everybody talks about, you want this, okay, you do this prayer. You want this, you do that prayer. In fact, in Hindus, we have a timetable, weekly timetable. Monday, you go to this temple. Tuesday, you go there. Wednesday, you go here. Thursday, one more song. Friday, some other ritual. Saturday, all these rituals we will be doing to various, some devatas. In the weekly list, I don't think Krishna is there. As of now, it's not there. And in some seasons, they replace the list with the seasonal rituals will be there. They replace with that. So this table devotion, that is everybody knows, is called table devotion. Vidura, Maitreya is not talking about table devotion or seasonal devotion. Suddenly you become big devotee. And after that, devotion is not visible. No. So, Eka Bhakti means Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Continuously, our devotion to Krishna is unceasing. Whether you have trouble, no trouble, whether Krishna gives or not gives, whether you are up or down, victory, failure, or rich, this, that, anything, our devotion to Krishna should not stop. This is called Eka Bhakti Govinda. If you only do bhakti when we are in suffering and when we get something from the Lord, immediately bhakti is evaporated. It's all in the cloud. Nowadays everything is in the cloud, right? our bhaktis also will be in the cloud. As soon as we get something, cloud. So that is the issue. So as long as this bhakti cloud is there, then our questions will continue. So here it is said, jataika bhaktir govinde tebhyascho upararamaha. Vidura retired from his questioning as soon as he realized that exclusive devotion to Krishna is the goal of life. Now, how do I practice this? Exclusive? Actually, once I was talking to one Muslim woman, and I was talking about this exclusive bhakti to God. And then, see, in any religion you see, this is an interesting, a new concept actually. Because everybody goes to God for tapatraya, in order to remove the tapatrayas, remove all our anxieties and miseries and all those things. But here, Bhagavatam is saying, you go to the God, you develop love for God, because to develop our attraction towards the Lord. We pray to God in order to increase our attraction to Krishna. We pray to God, Krishna, in order to increase our service to the Lord. Nowhere a devotee will ask, Krishna, I am having this trouble, you please remove this. He will not ask. Haridas Thakur was beaten up in 21 places by a whip. He never once asked, my Lord, you come and relieve me from this suffering. No. Prahlad was put into so much of difficulty. His own father, Hiranyakashipu, has put Prahlad, Bhakta Prahlad, into so many tribulations, including throwing off from a cliff and putting him into a boiling oil like that. But never once Prahlad said, my Lord, please come now and do something. No. Even in that situation also, he is thinking, what can I offer to Krishna? How can I develop my attraction to Krishna? He's simply chanting Krishna's name. It's a completely different understanding of bhakti altogether. He has been introduced in Srimad-Bhagavatam. And as soon as Vidura understood that, wow, yes, this is the, what is that word that is used? Atmanogatim. This is the Atmanogatim. This is the destination for the soul. What is that? Simply engage in unalloyed devotional service of Krishna. Don't mix anything. Unalloyed. It's not an alloy. It's an unalloyed. Okay, so as soon as he understood that, yes, this is my gati, then Uparama, he is retired from asking questions. But till as long as we don't reach that platform, we have to have lot of questions we have to ask. Particularly for practicing devotees, previously we used to ask a lot of questions. Brahma jijnasa, athato brahma jijnasa. We understood that yes, in human form of life, a human being has to inquire. Yes, what is all this? What is this world? Why these things are happening? Just by our observations, you can ask so many questions about life. Why am I suffering? Why so much cruelty I see? So much crime? What is the solution to all this? Everybody is asking these questions. So when a human being starts asking questions, that particularly connected to Brahma Jijnasa, not other Jada Jijnasa. Matter is Jada. No consciousness, inert matter. All our jijnasa is currently about jada. Jada jijnasa. We'll be asking, okay, you know, how to construct this, or how to move matter from here to there. Transport, anything you take, it's all about manipulating the matter. But our internal, the real personality is spiritual in nature. Any amount of material manipulation cannot satisfy. Now this is the question, problem. How can I satisfy? In Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes, if you see, there was one devotee by name Kolavecha Shrida. He is living in a small hut, and the hut is having many, many holes. During rainy season, a lot of water comes inside his hut. And he lives by making some small leaf cups. You know, every day he gets some 10 paisa, 25 paisa, something. During those days, there was also... So he used to maintain himself by that. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to his hut, he asked, okay, what do you want? Generally, what we will say, no, replace this hut with a five-story building or 14-story building, we want some big... So, Kolavecha Sridhar said, no, I don't want anything from you. And rather, from his income, he gave 50% to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's service. Instead of asking something from the Lord, he is trying to give something to the Lord. This is important. Devotee's mood is what I can give. Devotee's mood is not what I can take. What I can take is beginning devotion. What I can give is mature devotion. You see small children, they'll be always be pestering the father. Give me this, give me that, give me this, give me that. Right? Whatever they see, they want from the father. That's beginning. But let us say the same child grows into a lawyer or an engineer or whatever. He gets his first salary. What he will think? I should give something to my mother, my father. My first salary I want to give as a sari, or something he wants to give. That is mature. Similarly, in devotion also, asking, give me, that is small devotion. But if a devotee thinks, I want to give to Krishna, then that is mature. So this Muslim woman, she became very inquisitive. How is this possible? How can you not ask anything from God? How is that? Because, most of the religions, if you see, including their religion, everybody talks about how you can squeeze from the Lord. How much you can squeeze from, give me this, give me that, and all that. So to love God for what He is, a wonderful, beautiful, powerful, merciful, magnanimous personality, Krishna, for what He is, just to love Him for what He is, that is an extraordinary devotion. And that path is not very clearly visible, and that's why one has to approach a spiritual master. Here you can see Vidura went to Maitreya and asked, what is the goal of Atmanogatim? What is the goal of the spirit soul? Because he is already a very elevated person, that's why his question also very highly elevated. In our regular day-to-day affairs, you will not see anybody coming to you and saying, what is the goal of spirit soul? You will not. He'll say, I'm studying so-and-so. What should be my goal after 5 years? I'm doing this job. What should be my goal after 5 years? Everybody plans for five. Even the country plans for 5 years. Five-year plan and all those things. But then nobody is planning till the end of his life. And nobody is planning beyond that end. What happens after the life? Nobody is thinking. You are so meticulously planning, your 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. But after the death, where is your plan? So that's why Vidura is asking, Atmano Gatim, my dear sir, what is my destination? What should I do? And as soon as Maitreya convinced Vidura that, Eka Bhakti Govinde, then Uparama. Vidura is completely satisfied. He understood there is nothing more is required. So here, evataha krutavan prashnan. Prashna. Questions are very important. The quality of the questions are even more important. And what should be the quality? The quality of the question should be in a way that it can take us close to Krishna. It can give association of Krishna. So this is the devotee's life. Whether it is question, our answer, walking, sleeping, whatever it is Krishna, 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 Krishna. This is called unalloyed devotion. Whatever he does for Krishna. To grow in his devotion to Krishna, this is life. He has no other ulterior motive. He doesn't mix anything with that. Then only we can get satisfaction. Otherwise, we can never be satisfied because of the competitive spirit. For example, let us say you are given a plate of nice feast. 12-13 items are there. Gulab jamun, this, that, everything is there. And but you also saw the next person's plate. Everything is same, but he has got two gulab jamuns. So what happens to your satisfaction? Says, two. I got only one. You already have 13 items in front of you. You can happily enjoy meal and be happy. You got two. So this is the problem with satisfaction. You may have everything. In fact, the whole world can be kept under your feet, but you will be looking at the moon. You will be looking at something else. That also I want. This also. So greed, as long as we are greedy, we can never be satisfied. But the greediness can be diverted towards Krishna. Today, how many times I chanted Hare Krishna? Today, how many times I remember Krishna? Be greedy. Increase. He is chanting 16 rounds. Minimum, I should also chant in 16. He is chanting 16, I should chant 17. He distributed 5 Bhagavad Gitas, I should distribute 10. That competition is good. Not that, he is distributing so many books, I'll pull him down. So that he will not be able to do anything. That is not competition. That is called envy. Envy is about other people. You are doing something to the other person. Competition is about yourself. You want to improve yourself, contribute more and more. So, a devotee's life is about increasing his seva. How many times I can remember Krishna? How nicely I can do my services to the Lord? Now this is, book distribution is, I may be continuing, I just over. How I can give this knowledge to more and more people? How I can distribute more and more? Prabhupada said, we all have to chant 16 rounds every single day. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. So that sound should come out from your mouth and you should be absorbed in that sound. Morning, complete your bath, sit in front of Krishna picture and keep seeing Krishna and then nicely chant. You should chant in such a way that you are absorbed in that sound. The sound should go back. 16 rounds if you can do, absorb yourself in that sound, you will be washed in that sound. The transcendental effect of that sound will wash you of all contaminations. And then you will be very satisfied. Otherwise, we will not be able to satisfy ourselves by any other endeavor. So, don't wait for I will do chanting, but I am waiting for something to happen. Let my son is now studying, let him complete. And then after he completes, let him get married. After he marries, my grandchildren be educated, then let them be married, and then let them also settle. It goes on. Don't wait for anything. Nothing will settle in this world. Simply chant 16 rounds. This is the only solace. Whatever may be the situation, you want to be satisfied and happy, simply chant 16 rounds. And don't expect anything. Simply, as a service to Krishna, chant 16 rounds. My Lord, let my chanting be pleasing to you. That's all. I don't want anything. Just chant 16 rounds. Then that will have the transcendental effect. That's called loving devotional service to Krishna. Any questions? Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srimad-Bhagavatam ki jai.
Hare Krishna. Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any updates.